arraigned prosecutors this afternoon detailing the grand jury indictments of the New York Republican, his son, and his son's fiance's father for 13 counts of securities fraud, wire fraud, and false statements, all stemming from an alleged insider trading scheme involving an Australian biotech firm for which Collins was a board member. And it's difficult not to notice that the president, who repeatedly declared himself the law and order candidate on the campaign trail, whose crowds continue to enthusiastically chant that his erstwhile opponent, Hillary Clinton, should be locked up, that president sure seems to have a lot of people in his orbit who seem to run afoul of the law. Beyond his first congressional backer arrested, just in the last day, the president's former deputy campaign chairman, Rick Gates, was testifying about crimes he says he committed with President Trump's former campaign chairman, Paul Manafort. Plus, CNN also has learned that the president's former fixer and longtime attorney, Michael Cohen, is under federal investigation for tax fraud. That's just the last day. Now, on the one hand, the public can seemingly be reassured that American institutions of law enforcement continue to do their jobs, pursuing criminality wherever they see it, without fear or favor, with no evidence of any inappropriate influence being wielded to protect those who are close to the president. That's good news. On the other hand, those who enthusiastically thought electing President Trump might mean he would drain the swamp, they likely didn't believe so many of those critters in the swamp were the president's friends and allies. I want to bring in CNN's Bryn Gingras, who's live outside the federal courthouse where moments ago Collins made his first court appearance. And Bryn, we just learned that Collins is going to hold a press conference in a couple hours.
Yeah, that's right, Jake, at 6:30 in Buffalo. And we saw the congressman and his team of attorneys come out this federal courthouse here behind me, jump into an SUV, likely headed in that direction for that press conference. But inside the courtroom, the congressman, his 25-year-old son Cameron, and his soon-to-be father-in-law all appeared calm when they pleaded not guilty to the judge. But anything but calm is what prosecutors say all three men were when they learned about this drug and how it failed the clinical trial and the alleged swift action they took to unload their stocks and save hundreds of thousands of dollars, according to the prosecutors, doing all this above the law, thinking they were above the law. Republican Congressman Chris Collins, the first member of Congress to support Donald Trump, appearing in court late this afternoon after federal prosecutors charged him, his son Cameron, and another man, Stephen Czarski, with 13 counts of securities fraud, wire fraud, and making a false statement to the FBI. The charges stemming from an alleged insider trading scheme, which partially played out on the South Lawn of the White House, according to court documents. At the center of it all, an Australian pharmaceutical company called Innate Immunotherapeutics, where Collins was a board member.
Congressman Collins was told some confidential and highly sensitive information about Innate, information that was not yet made public, namely, that Innate's main drug, the drug Innate was developing to be the backbone of its company, was a total failure.
According to the 30-page complaint, that conversation happened while Collins attended the annual congressional picnic at the White House. Federal prosecutors say Collins received an email at 6:55 p.m. that the drug had failed its trial. At 7:10 p.m., Collins responded to the email and then proceeded to try to reach his son Cameron, the two placing six calls over a period of 5 minutes. Later that night, Cameron drove to the home of Stephen Czarski, the father of his fiance. And at 9:34 p.m., Czarski's wife placed a call to their stockbroker to sell shares of the company, according to the complaint. Prosecutors allege that between the opening of the market on Friday, June 23rd, and the close of business on the following Monday, Cameron Collins sold a total of nearly 1.4 million shares of Innate. All in all, prosecutors allege that Collins and the other defendants avoided more than $750,000 in losses on the stock.
Congressman Collins cheated our markets and our justice system in two ways. First, he tipped his son to confidential corporate information at the expense of regular investors, and then he lied about it to law enforcement to cover it up.
Collins, who represents upstate New York, became a frequent Trump surrogate on cable news during the 2016 campaign. His lawyers saying in a statement, quote, "We will answer the charges filed against Congressman Collins in court and will mount a vigorous defense to clear his good name. We are confident he will be completely vindicated and exonerated." Now, each of the men had to sign over a $500,000 personal recognizance bond, and they each had to turn over their passports. Jake, as you heard, the attorneys for both Cameron and the congressman vehemently deny these allegations. Of course, though, we'll hear more from the congressman when he appears for that news conference in Buffalo around 6:30. Jake.
All right, Bryn Gingras in New York. Thanks so much. Let's talk about with our panel. I want to set the scene for a second because Bryn did mention this White House. Now, none of this has to do with President Trump directly, of course, but on June 22nd, 2017, that's when prosecutors say Congressman Collins got that email, including insider information, and started calling his son. It just so happens Collins was at the congressional picnic at the White House, surrounded by his colleagues, tons of people. Look at this part. This was at 7:30. Everyone's taking pictures. Collins looks a little distracted. Perhaps he's looking down at his phone. This is exactly 14 minutes after Collins, according to prosecutors, called his son to give him the tip. I mean, it really is remarkable. Again, innocent until proven guilty, but people seem to think that there aren't going to be investigations or records of these things.
The term that people use, the culture of corruption, like him being there in that environment and making, that is literally a culture of corruption. That's what that is. And at this point, like with all the people accused of these sort of acts, it's like starting to feel like looting. It's starting to feel like people came in and they're just like, get everything, you like a supermarket sweep of criminality. And they're just running through with their arm out, trying to get everything into the cart. And it also makes me feel like every time President Trump talks about, well, it's a witch hunt, and then you see stuff like this, like the Commerce Secretary, these are your garden variety corruption issues in the sense that it's stuff that has happened in more isolated cases in the past. So it's very hard to say that, therefore, it's a witch hunt that's politically motivated when it's pretty cut and dried. Somebody took something they weren't supposed to take.
Very rare to indict a sitting congressman, especially within 100 days of the election.
Well, as you said, they will go through the evidence and have a trial, but the timing of the email and then the phone call and then the selling of stocks is quite suspicious.
Before the bad news comes out to make the stocks
sink. Yeah, and the thing is with all the issues that you listed, no one can keep their nose clean, and that's been like for a long time in Washington, but like in this administration in particular, there's no message from the top to keep your nose clean. In fact, sometimes quite the opposite. And so people do not act the way they should and are tempted to act other ways and are not told otherwise.
I think people will be surprised to discover that you could be a congressman, a fairly not so unsenior congressman on the Energy and Commerce Committee, which regulates the drug industry, the pharmaceutical industry. You can sit on the board of a company. You can introduce legislation, which he did incidentally before this all happened, that would seems to have benefited that company, buy a lot of the stock when that legislation looks like it's going to pass. And then you get a phone call as a director from the CEO, I guess it was, and you appear to dump the stock or tell your son to dump the family stock or some chunk of it before the rest of the world knows. I mean, I don't know. Is it that much to ask that maybe congressmen shouldn't sit on boards of directors or shouldn't trade stocks?
They could just told.
Yeah. Well, seriously, that's an honest question. That is, I'm personally surprised. When I went into the White House and my chief of staff, the vice president, I wasn't going to do anything that was going to affect anything. I put all my money in mutual funds. It just seemed like the obvious thing to do. You can't be like owning. What if you own a stock and something comes up? And this is an actual member of Congress. So that's one thing I would say. Maybe someone should introduce legislation to make that happen. That would not be a bad thing.
I mean,
for Senator Schumer and Leader Pelosi on the Democratic side to try to make a fuss about and try to demand a vote on it in September. That I think is one thing that will happen.
Some people don't think the rules apply for them. I think the photo that you showed at the top of the show, Jake, that's what the streets like to call receipts. And that photo was receipts, and I think it's pretty damning and slightly incriminating. Now, the congressman currently sits in the 27th Congressional District. Sabato's Cristobal had it at a solid Republican seat. With this news, it has now moved to a likely Republican seat. I think that, folks, the Democrat in the race is already raising money off of this. And so this just goes to show that any type of conduct can open up the doors for Democrats to gain all types of seats this fall that probably weren't on the table before.
There is a culture of corruption in Washington. It did precede Donald Trump, and it is bipartisan. We've seen this before. There was that 60 Minutes report about the insider trading where you're allowed to legislate things for and then trade accordingly, and the Congress did apparently try to close that loophole. And yet there's something so brazen about this, including, Mary Catherine, the fact that he allegedly lied to investigators about it, even though there's a whole paper trail and phone trail.
Right, and that's what people hate about this town, is the fact that people feel entitled to do that. And it's counterintuitively why they ended up, many of them, voting for Donald Trump, who, of course, at the time, I argued, was not going to be the great cleaner of this system. But it is why people looked for something completely outside the system to attempt to get them there. And I think we see over and over again that's not the case. Electorally, I would wonder whether this, the culture of corruption tag, can have the same impact as it might have had in like a 2006 with the Mark Foley scandals. Because the news cycle is so fast and so furious, and we have so many of these stories, I think we have seen the impact go down, which is regrettable to some extent.
Well, can I say something in defense, though, in defense of this town? There's also a culture of integrity in this town. What about the Justice Department?
Yeah.
They indicted. This is Trump's Justice Department. These are people who report to people. Yes. I mean, that's pretty impressive, actually.
That U.S. Attorney, Berman, was appointed by President Trump and, in fact, had an interview with President Trump.
So I'm, you know, would want to say that we should be a little, you know, there is a culture of corruption, but there's also something impressive about the way the Justice Department has behaved in this and in other instances.
To add one nuance to this, like when you say, you know, how brazen it is, I remember when I was in the State House in Jefferson City and I would see, like, on a bill about pharmacy benefits, somebody would stand up and say, well, I'm a pharmacist, so I'm going, and I remember, like, my head exploding because I was thinking, well, perhaps then you shouldn't speak on this because it has a financial interest for you. And I always would go back to the idea that frequently, and I think this happens in Washington, too, people mistake conflict of interest for expertise. Mm. And so, and I don't know if that's the case here, but, like, Bill, when you were, I mean, I agree with you, it's ridiculous that you can have this kind of, you know, sit on a board and be on that committee. But I guarantee you, well, I'm likely anyway, that he had conversations where he was like, well, actually, I know quite a lot about this because I sit on, and people are like, oh, we should listen to this guy because he's on that board. That's the problem, is they can't tell the difference between conflict of interest and expertise.
Well, absolutely. But then the other question here is, this has been allowed to go on because the Congress, the folks in Congress are not necessarily regulating themselves. You know, I would venture to say Congressman Collins is the only person that sits on a pharmaceutical board or a health board here or a board over there. And so who is going to check the checker? That is what the American people, I think, are asking to.
And that's one of the things that we've seen in this town, is that ultimately there's sometimes, a lot of times, the Democrats won't take actions that would hurt Republicans because they're also worried about their own members. And who knows what's going on with Democratic congressmen. Obviously, this is Chris Collins. He's a Republican. But you haven't really seen a stampede of people saying, we need to clean this up today.
No, I mean, it is all driven by some self-interest and sometimes partisan interest. And they look ahead to, like, well, what if I get in the crosshairs of this committee at some point? And that doesn't feel great to me. So you sort of get some piddling investigations upon investigations upon investigations of themselves in Congress. But it often does not really cut through.
The Democrats would be crazy, in my view, challengers against Republicans, not to run, as someone was suggesting.
Yes. Murray is running.
Part of that is saying no Nancy Pelosi, no business as usual, none of the same rules, really clean the place up.
Well, you had her, then you lost her.
you had me, and then I was like, wait, I'm not with Bill.
Everyone stick around. President Trump is finally responding to Bob Mueller's request for an interview, but is the counteroffer from the Trump team an honest effort to make a deal or just a stalling tactic, plus a coordinated pressure campaign targeting Ivanka Trump by celebrities? But is the first daughter willing to listen to the people she follows on Instagram? Stay with us. This afternoon, President Trump's legal team made its latest counteroffer to special counsel Robert Mueller regarding his official request for an interview with President Trump. Mr. Trump's lawyer suggested setting limits on what Mueller can ask. Now, how much of all of this is actual negotiation and how much is kabuki-like theater is anyone's guess. CNN's Caitlin Collins is in New Jersey, near where the president's doing his working vacation. And Caitlin, the possible conditions in this offer could be a sure sign that the two sides are nowhere near a deal and frankly, might never be.
That's right, Jake. What we seem to be seeing here today with this response from the president's legal team to the special counsel does not seem to be closing the gap between these two sides who have been negotiating for 8 months. Instead, it seems to be showing us just how far apart they remain. President Trump's legal team responding to the special counsel's latest request for an interview today.
We have now given him an answer. He should take a few days to consider it. But we should get this resolved.
The president's lawyers declining to characterize their response to Robert Mueller.
We're not going to discuss the contents of the letter that we will send, but I will tell you this, that our response is thoughtful and includes issues that are raised under the Constitution. So I will leave it at that.
While urging him once again to bring the investigation to an end.
We do not want to run into the November elections. So back up from that. This should be over with by September 1st.
The response is the latest in the back and forth between the two sides that has dragged on for 8 months now. Mueller indicated last week he'd be willing to limit the number of questions about obstruction of justice, while maintaining he still wanted to ask those questions in person. Today, Giuliani making clear certain questions are off limits.
I could right now give you the answer that he's going to give to the question, why did you fire Jim Comey? He gave it. He gave it to Lester Holt. It's on tape.
Openly admitting he's worried the president could perjure himself.
I start to think that the only reason they want this explanation is so that they can come up with some kind of a perjury thing.
What's called a perjury trap is something that we've talked about often.
While Trump has ramped up his public attacks on the special counsel, he remains at odds with his own legal team over the prospect of an interview.
The president stated that he wants to do an interview. I will tell you the position of the legal team is that we do not advise that.
Jay Sekulow admitting,
ultimately the decision's up to the president.
Now, the president and the reason he wants to get in front of the special counsel is because he believes he can communicate his innocence to him and bring this investigation to an end. Now, if the president's legal team declines the special counsel's interview request, it could set us up for a showdown in court over a subpoena, a presidential subpoena, something that has only happened to one other president in office. Jake.
All right, Caitlin Collins with the president in New Jersey. Up next, the other letter, what we know was in that special delivery Senator Rand Paul gave to be given to Russian President Vladimir Putin in his solo trip to Russia. Stay with us. We're back with breaking news in our worldly. The Trump administration announcing just minutes ago that they're going to impose new sanctions on Russia. These sanctions come in response to the poisoning of former Russian spy Sergei Skripal and his daughter Yulia, the United Kingdom blaming Russia for using a military-grade Soviet-era nerve agent that nearly killed them on U.K. soil. Moscow has denied that charge. CNN's Jim Sciutto joins me now. Jim, what can you tell me about these sanctions?
Well, the first thing we should note is that these sanctions are required by law, long existing U.S. law, when it's determined by the U.S. that a country has used chemical weapons, as the U.S. has determined here, that Russia used a chemical weapon to attempt to commit murder on U.K. soil. We should note that the Trump administration is imposing these sanctions about 30 days after the deadline imposed by that law, but they are following the law as it's written. You have two potential rounds here. The first round of sanctions, relatively light. It can affect some exports, some financing. The real test is going to be if Russia does not allow inspections of chemical weapons facilities and does not make assurances they will not use chemical weapons again, then there are even harsher sanctions that could ban all imports and exports and diplomatic relations. That will really be the real test for this administration.
Interesting. So their fans is forced. They're kind of in doing this because they have to. That's
yes,
the law.
Exactly.
And earlier today, an interesting move, Senator Rand Paul, Republican of Kentucky, delivering by hand a letter from President Trump giving it to Putin's administration in Russia. It's not really clear what's in the letter, though.
No, it's not. And initially, Rand Paul advertised this as something, as he was sort of a courier here between President Trump and President Vladimir Putin. But we are told by White House sources that, in fact, President Trump was, in effect, doing a favor for Rand Paul. Rand Paul was in Moscow. He wanted to meet with the Russian president. And President Trump, this according to the White House, wrote a letter of introduction and that this was not some secret communication between Trump and Putin.
Tonight, Republican Senator Rand Paul announcing that he delivered a letter to Russian President Vladimir Putin, which he claimed was from President Donald Trump, tweeting, quote, "The letter emphasized the importance of further engagement in various areas, including countering terrorism, enhancing legislative dialogue, and resuming cultural exchanges." The White House, however, says the letter was written at the request of the senator, not the president, to help Paul obtain a meeting with Putin that has not happened during his solo trip to Russia. President Trump provided a letter of introduction, Hogan Gidley, deputy press secretary, said in a statement. In the letter, the president mentioned topics of interest that Senator Paul wanted to discuss with President Putin. Senator Paul and Mr. Trump, however, share an interest in improving relations between the U.S. and Russia. While in Moscow, Paul spoke of the need for diplomacy.
Diplomacy, conversations, dialogue, communication, all of that is incredibly important. And my goal in coming to Russia is to say that we want to have open lines of communication.
However, Paul did not answer CNN's question when asked if he confronted Russian officials
about Russia's ongoing interference in U.S. politics.
Senator, did you speak about election interference as well? Did that come up?
We had general discussions about a lot of issues, and basically we've decided that right now what we're trying to do is have dialogue, and I don't think we solve issues other than, see, our biggest issue right now is no dialogue. It isn't the issues at hand.
Paul's apparent lack of urgency stands in sharp contrast to the nation's senior most national security officials. Just last week, they delivered the stark warning that Russian interference remains pervasive today.
It goes beyond the elections. It goes to Russia's intent to undermine our democratic values.
Now, Putin's press secretary says that this letter was delivered through what he called diplomatic channels. They say, the Kremlin, that they have not yet reviewed it. And we should note that the meeting between Trump, or rather between Putin and Paul, has not happened. Jake?
All right, Jim Shooter, thanks so much. We'll talk about it with our experts. Now, Mary Catherine, there's just this schizophrenic foreign policy when it comes to Russia. I don't really understand. On one hand, you have Coates and Ray and all the national security officials saying the Russians are, they attacked us since 2016, cyber. They're doing it again right now. And then you have President Trump and Rand Paul, who seem to be on a different page.
Right, yeah, you constantly have this huge divergence between what the president specifically is saying publicly and the policies that they're putting in place, many of which are tough and good. But that's a problem because what the president says matters. Now, Rand Paul has always been more on the interventionist, leaning toward isolationist side when it comes to foreign policy than many people in the Senate. So this isn't like a huge shift for him. But I hate the way this is being framed by many Trump supporters and by more libertarian parts of the party, where it says it's either war or diplomacy. It's all out war, it's diplomacy. We can do diplomacy with a more clear-eyed vision of exactly what Putin is and exactly what Russia is trying to do. Moral clarity and diplomacy can go together.
What is Rand Paul meeting with Putin going to do about Claire McCaskill, who's still getting hacked by the Russians in Missouri? I just don't understand this insatiable need of some people in Congress to run over there and meet with President Putin. It just makes no sense to me. When we are currently under threat, we are less than 100 days from the midterm elections. And for our cybersecurity-wise, there are many people that are, in fact, not safe. So I just think that folks need to be taking this a lot more seriously. And I hope that Rand Paul gets a reaming when he gets back to Congress from some of his colleagues that are asking him what the hell he is doing.
I'm with Simone, you know, that's very much welcome to a hawkish foreign policy.
Read it. Glad to be here today.
Why is Trump writing a letter for Rand Paul? I mean, Rand Paul is
consistent. This guy's all right.
What?
You open it up, it says made guy.
Yeah. No, I mean, seriously, he has an ambassador if he wish to Moscow, John Huntsman, if he wishes to transmit messages to Vladimir Putin. He can pick up the phone and talk to him, I suppose. He's got a national security advisor. Paul has been against. He voted, didn't those sanctions, I think, have passed. I may have one of those bills.
Oh, yeah, one of the 98
to 2. It was like 98 to 2. He's one of the two. He is against the policy of the huge majority of Congress on Putin, which Trump has reluctantly acceded to in some respects. So giving Paul the letter really undercuts the notion that there is a tough Russia policy, I think.
Sometimes it's helpful to step back and look at this from high up. And what I'm reminded of is, you know, you talk about like a schizophrenic foreign policy. Like, we're supposed to be like one big family, like it's supposed to stop at the water's edge. And it just reminds me of, like, when I was a kid and my younger brother was smaller than me, like, we'd get in fights and, like, I'd beat him up a little. But, like, if you came from down the street and tried to beat up my little brother, I was going to kick your butt.
Right.
That's how it's always worked in this country for the most part. It's that Republicans and Democrats, we have arguments inside the House. But if you come and try and attack the House or come after one of us, like, we band together and kick your butt. This is not how it's supposed to go, and apparently the way you get in the good graces of President Trump is you say, hey, I'd love to go meet with your buddy Putin.
Now, you pointed out that this is not new, this kind of foreign policy for Rand Paul. He's been a skeptic of the more hawkish foreign policy towards Russia. But what is interesting is he's been very critical when they were running against each other of Donald Trump, specifically on how Donald Trump would handle Vladimir Putin. In fact, during that second Republican debate that I moderated in Simi Valley at the Reagan Library, take a listen to what Rand Paul had to say about Donald Trump.
Do we want someone with that kind of character, that kind of careless language, to be negotiating with Putin?
Apparently so.
That is a good question, Senator Paul. And this, I also take issue with Paul said the problem is there is no dialogue. The president just sat down with Putin very recently, as we all remember, and that the dialogue may be some of the problem, and his careless speaking within said dialogue is part of the problem. So I agree with old Senator Paul, I guess.
Well, I guess the other question, Bill, is If the Russians are still attacking the United States, Facebook just last week, I think, took down some ads that were supposedly by the Russians trying to foment discord in the United States. You had Dan Coats, all these intelligence people talking about how the Russians are still attacking us. Why is there this constant need to go and talk to people who are attacking the citizens of the United States?
No, it's pathetic. It's not, they're also attacking Russian dissidents in England, a good in Britain, an ally of ours, and killing, actually, one woman, a British woman, right, inadvertently, I guess, as a result of their... But they have an attack, chemical weapons on British soil. Look, if a bipartisan delegation, this is sort of Jason's way, a bipartisan delegation went over there, senior senator, senior congressman said to talk tough to Putin and say, we have a bipartisan consensus in this country that you will pay a big price for continuing to do this and also for other things you're doing in Ukraine and elsewhere and in Britain. That would be one thing. There's a case for Congress weighing in support of a tough U.S. foreign policy. There's not much case for one senator going over and trying to undercut American foreign policy.
And Mary Catherine, Rand Paul spoke last month about the importance of diplomacy with Russia, and it kind of gets to the false choice that you say he makes. Take a listen.
Nobody is saying or excusing Russia's meddling in our elections. Absolutely. We should protect the integrity of our elections. But simply bringing the hatred of the president to the Senate floor in order to say, we're done with diplomacy. The hatred for the president is so intense that partisans would rather risk war than give diplomacy a chance.
Is that you? Are you a partisan that would rather risk war because you hate Donald Trump so much?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that diplomacy has been the reason for like a really long time that we didn't go directly to war with Russia or the Soviet Union. So I really don't get the idea that like for the longest time we've been having this debate, should we go to war with Russia or should we have diplomacy? I think that's not true. It's really more like he's saying like someone is trying to burglarize his house and he's like, we should just talk to them. I mean, it doesn't make any sense.
Is it appeasement, do you think?
Well, as Simone points out, there's also urgency here because we are close to an election, and that's what they're trying to mess with. So having it present, you know, at the top of your mind and dealing with it strictly is important.
Everyone stick around. We got a lot more to talk about. The president may be touting a GOP sweep in the latest primaries, but not so fast. The red alerts show the results about Republicans and Democrats about November. Stay with us. And we're back with the politics lead. Are the lights blinking red for Republicans in November? Last night's special election race in Ohio's 12th congressional district is still too close to call. Republican Troy Balderson is claiming victory. He has a narrow lead, but his Democratic opponent, Danny O'Connor, has not conceded, given that the number of votes that have yet to be counted outnumber the slim margin of Balderson's lead. It's a seat that's been safely in Republican hands since Ronald Reagan was president. Either way, the two candidates are going to square off again come November. Let's talk about the election results. Jason Kander, you're a former Democratic Secretary of State in Missouri, and you just put out a new book titled Outside the Wire, The Lessons I've Learned in Everyday Courage. It partly focuses on your life in politics and the military, gives advice for Democrats in 2018 and beyond. What lessons are you taking from the Ohio 12th race last night, where it looks like the Republican probably eked out a victory?
Well, first of all, as you mentioned, like this district has been Republican since 1982. I mean, I was born in 1981, so that seems like a pretty long time ago, right? And I guess the lesson to take from all of this that we've seen recently is Democrats, we sort of have our mojo back and we're out there making an argument. And one of the points that I make in Outside the Wire is that you have to go out and actually try to convince people of things, because that's how they know that you're passionate enough and that you actually care enough to try and fight for them. Passion is persuasive. One of the stories I tell in the book is that one of the very first doors I ever knocked on, a fellow came to the door. It was clear immediately that we didn't agree on things. I started to get nervous about it. I started to do what I'd seen politicians on TV do. I'm trying to convince this fellow we actually agree. It gets worse. And then I just decide, like, I got to move on. So I thank him for his time, say that's what I believe. And as I'm walking away, he goes, well, that's fair. I'll vote for you. You can put a sign in my yard. And the lesson from that is, it's not a test. It's not a multiple choice test where they're going down with an Excel spreadsheet and saying, well, they're with me on this. They're trying to figure out if you care enough to say what you really believe, and that if you believe what you do because you care about them. That's all of politics right there.
That's an interesting story. Mary Catherine, the president, taking credit for Troy Balderson's victory. He tweeted, quote, when I decided to go to Ohio for Troy Balderson, he was down in early voting 64-36. That was not good. After my speech on Saturday night, there was a big turn for the better. Now Troy wins a great victory during a very tough time of the year for voting. He will win big in November. He noted in follow-up tweets that he went 5 for 5. That's a reference to the five candidates that he endorsed, 1 in a special election and 4 in primaries. winning. Does he deserve some credit here?
I mean, if anything, it might be a win for the great historic Trump-Kasich alliance. I'm only half kidding. But there was lower turnout than expected in the rural areas, which you would expect Trump to sort of pump up, and Kasich's areas, the more educated ex-urban and suburban areas, had better turnout. It would be crazy for Republicans not to see this as a warning sign. This is a hugely Republican district. We're getting very close to the November election. This should be every reason in the world to make sure you have your T's crossed and your I's dotted. And I think Democrats have shown surprisingly good in special elections of turning enthusiasm into actual GOTV. Alabama, I think, was the first example of this. And it doesn't always pull them across the line, but special elections are very hard. And a regular election is a bit easier. And many of these districts are going to be tougher than this district.
Yeah,
Republicans.
There's a race in Kansas for a gubernatorial primary. President Trump endorsing Kris Kobach, Secretary of State, over the incumbent governor. And right now, Kobach is leading by less than 200 votes over the incumbent governor. Kobach's the Secretary of State. He said he's not going to recuse himself from any sort of state-level recount. I'll get your take on this in a second, but what do you think about that? I mean, just in the name of ethics, shouldn't he, given that it's his own race?
Well, you'd think so, and I think it's pretty straightforward to supervise a recount, honestly, just make sure that everyone's behaving, doing things according to the book, so why not recuse yourself, you would think. Democrats think he'll be easier to, they will have a chance of winning if Kobach does win the nomination. They nominated an attractive candidate. The two of the Kansas seats have just moved in a couple of the ratings, you know, to do this professionally, from lead Republican or likely Republican to toss-ups. If you look over at Kansas, Michigan, Washington, as well as Ohio, the three states that had primaries yesterday, they all look pretty good for the Democrats. Better turnout. If you look at how many people voted in each party, obviously there weren't Republican versus Democratic matchups. But so Republicans should be worried. Honestly, I joked about Pelosi before. The single card Republicans have left to play, I talked to a Republican operative about this morning, is Nancy Pelosi in these House seats. There are a lot of people. Think about this issue. You voted Republican all your life since 1982. You're a swing voter, an upper middle class swing voter outside Columbus. And you don't like Trump, and you think maybe a Democratic House could check Trump, and maybe this Democrat who's been nominated is pretty moderate, and you could live with it for at least 2-4 years. And then they show the picture of Nancy Pelosi in the Democratic House and everything you've disliked about the Democratic Party, fair or unfair, but you remember, you're a Republican voter by definition, right, for the last 10 years, 20 years, comes back. And I think if she stood up, if she took had a press conference on October 15th and said, I will work my heart out to help Democrats win the House, and I will not stand for Speaker. I'll let another generation take
Nancy
over.
Pelosi
that would put the Democrats unambiguously
so
over
I,
the
so
top,
to be clear,
and they'd probably
I don't
win
work,
the Senate, too. And
I don't
win
work
the
for,
Senate
nor
too.
Do I advise Leader Pelosi, but what I will say is this. The fact of the matter is, if that's the card that Republicans running all across the country have to play, it's a sad place to be, and that blue wave will definitely be coming.
I would normally agree with you, but I feel like it keeps working.
No, but it's
way.
Not working
it works
the fact, because
yeah.
What I'm telling you is that, look, these. I think we're not giving voters enough credit. Folks living in, again, McDowell County, West Virginia, places in Missouri, I mean, out in Michigan, they are just not thinking about Nancy Pelosi. They're thinking about health care. They're thinking about education. They're thinking about
the
economy.
I just say Republican operatives are spending a lot of money on ads.
And they are losing, is what I'm telling you. They are losing.
They should keep doing
that. They are losing. I want them to keep spending their money.
Can we go back to Kobach for a second?
Yeah, but what would you do as Secretary of State? You didn't have a recount when you ran.
I was on the ballot.
Rub it in there, Jake. That was really nice.
When you ran for Senate, you were Secretary of State, and you didn't have a recount, but...
We had a plan in place.
We did.
Had a plan in place. The plan was I was going to recuse myself. We knew it was going to be a very close... It's obvious, right? And now we're talking about there's 200 votes difference, and here's what I'm worried about. Like, I'm obviously largely worried about, at the bigger level, the fact that I'm running to be the mayor of Kansas City, which borders Kansas, and so I have many reasons why I do not want Kris Kobach to be the governor next door, and we could do a whole show about that, but we probably can't. Although, invite me back, and I'm happy to do it. I would love to do that show, because, anyway.
First, you'd have to explain why Kansas City isn't in Kansas, and why it borders Kansas.
All right.
That's so confusing.
Let's a whole show on Kansas City. I think that's a great idea.
Okay, keep going.
Kris Kobach. Look, the reason I think it's really scary is, one, look, it's 200 votes, and he shouldn't be in charge of counting those 200 votes when he's on the ballot, which is why I was going to recuse myself. But what I'm worried about right now in this moment that people need to know is that Kris Kobach has a very dangerous superpower that he will deploy in the next few days, a villainous superpower. And it is he can say racist or extremist or horrible or dangerous things, and he can do it in a very reasonable-sounding tone that sometimes will deceive his audience. And I guarantee you he's about to do that about whether or not a Secretary of State who's on the ballot for governor should conduct their own recount. And I hope people are watching.
I should note that we invite Mr. Kobach to come on and respond to what you just said. But Simone, I do want to ask you one thing, because obviously one of the other stories last night was the fact that a lot of the more left-leaning Democrats did not win. In fact, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, she endorsed a whole bunch of candidates, and most of them lost. Does this suggest that Democrats are actually much more centrist and less enamored with the Bernie Sanders wing from which you come, or not?
No, I don't think that's what it suggests at all. Look, I think it suggests that in some places, people ran better campaigns. I look at Sharice Davids in Kansas City. What is it? Yeah, Kansas, District 3, yeah. Who was poised to be the first Native American woman elected to Congress. She won her primary. She's a progressive. So I think that it depends on how you run a race, where you're running. But she wasn't endorsed. But who's to say that Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, or to even just be frank, our revolution is the only stamp you need to be progressive. There are progressive people out there that work for Bernie Sanders that don't like me. They think I sold out, Jake. They are not the barometer by which I judge my progressiveness today.
Can I say one more thing about that?